Hey everyone, welcome back to our channel, the go-to place for information and strategies on learning disabilities, especially ADHD. In this video series, we're sharing some of the potential ADHD treatments specialists can recommend for your child's ADHD. That way you know what to expect and how to go about treating ADHD. In today's video, we're just going to cover the different kinds of ADHD education services that are effective for helping students with ADHD, explain why they're helpful, and how to go about getting them for your child. Specifically, this series covers exactly how official and authoritative resources that have actually proven their legitimacy, like the Mayo Clinic, the National Institute of Mental Health, or NIMH, the Childmind Institute, Children and Adults with Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, or CHAD, WebMD, and the American Psychiatric Association, among others, recommend ADHD treatments for children, teens, and adults. Now, these are the exact same resources Dan Kramarski, a school administrator for over 30 years and the lead instructor for our upcoming course on how to help parents handle the transition to middle school for their kids with ADHD, has used to treat his own ADHD and that of his daughter, who is now a successful university student. And we know most parents would be happy knowing their kids will make it through high school safely. So take Dan as an example case study and listen closely. This series covers four standard treatments for ADHD in children, including medications, like stimulants, other medications, and how to give medications safely, behavior therapy, like social skills training and parent skills training, counseling, like psychotherapy and family therapy. If you haven't watched our videos about ADHD diagnosis, medications, behavioral therapies, and counseling, click the annotation on the top right of your screen to watch those videos. And lastly, education services, like school programs, individualized education programs, or IEPs, and 504 plans, which is what we'll be covering in today's video. Using these four treatment methods, you and your medical professional should jointly develop a treatment plan that prioritizes and addresses each problem area for your child. Now, these areas can include school challenges, self-esteem, anger management issues, co-occurring disorders such as depression or anxiety, any learning concerns, and peer and family relationships. However, a more comprehensive treatment plan that really covers all your bases would include all or some of the following based on the unique needs of your child. Learning more about ADHD as a disorder and its causes. Learning more about diagnosing ADHD and the potential options for treatment. Hopefully we've got you covered there. Setting up behavioral therapy for your child to help manage his or her behaviors and also to acquire new skills for handling them autonomously. Understanding the differences between ADHD medications and prescriptions and how to set up regular monitoring after trying a new medication. Getting mental health counseling for you, your child, or the whole family to address things like relationships, self-esteem, discipline, and other parenting concerns. Setting up educational program modifications and supports, including 504 plans, tutoring, and special education programs. And finally, whether you should consider taking parent training classes or programs from an ADHD coach to address your child's behavior both at school and at home. An ADHD coach can also potentially help with marriage counseling, since we know that, statistically, parents of kids with ADHD are twice as likely to get a divorce than other parents of neurotypical kids. Now, if you want to set up a comprehensive treatment plan like that, sign up for our upcoming course taught by Dan and other ADHD experts like psychiatrists, school psychologists, pediatric neuropsychologists, behavioral therapists, and ADHD coaches. It'll help you set up and execute your child's personalized treatment plan, better your relationships both at school and at home, and handle the entire process of transitioning to middle school. Check out the link to the course in the description below. So, treating ADHD often requires medical, educational, behavioral, and psychological intervention. This comprehensive approach to treatment is sometimes called multimodal because it incorporates so many different modes of treatment. However, although these treatments can relieve many of the symptoms of ADHD and even improve physical coordination, they do not cure it. While there is no cure for ADHD, currently available treatments can help reduce symptoms and improve functioning. Just know that it may take some time to determine what works best for your child. Also, as both a medical and health disclaimer, I am not a doctor and this video does not provide medical or health advice. It is intended for informational purposes only. It is not a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. Never ignore professional medical advice or seeking treatment because of something you've heard on this YouTube channel or from Smart Course as a whole. If you think you may have a medical emergency, immediately call your doctor or dial 911. ADHD patient symptoms vary significantly, so it is extremely important to speak with your physician or medical professional in order to come up with a tailored approach that works specifically for you and your child. That being said, and all things being clear, let's go over some of the best information out there. First, you're probably watching this video because you're wondering, what is the most effective ADHD treatment? Well, based on both the Childmind Institute and the American Psychiatric Association, research shows that a combined approach of medication and behavioral therapy is the most effective treatment. For moderate to severe cases of ADHD, the first line of treatment is usually medication. more specifically ADHD medications called psychostimulants, which increase the amount of certain chemicals in the brain, help children focus, and curb impulsivity and hyperactivity. Behavioral therapies, on the other hand, help kids rein in impulsive behavior and be better organized. Counseling, like psychotherapy and family therapy, can still be very helpful and may be necessary for some children with coexisting conditions, such as anxiety or depression. In these cases, counseling may help both ADHD and the coexisting problem. So again, if you haven't watched our videos on getting an ADHD diagnosis, ADHD medications, behavioral therapies, or counseling, please click the annotation in the top right of your screen to watch those videos. On the other hand, education services can help students cope with schoolwork, tests, and learning effectively in the classroom. They can also help teachers maintain invaluable communication with parents about a student's behavior and performance, which can really help keep kids on track. Now, in general, to treat ADHD effectively, more than one intervention is needed. By working closely with your healthcare providers and school personnel, you will be able to find the treatment options that are most suited to the unique needs of your child and family. Close cooperation among therapists, doctors, teachers, and parents is therefore very important. What are education services? ADHD can affect learning and development from a very young age. Public school systems, some private schools, and even colleges and universities are required to help students with ADHD and other disabilities rise to meet educational challenges. Children with all three types of ADHD, predominantly inattentive, predominantly hyperactive, and the combined type, may face many challenges in a traditional school setting and may qualify for educational services and accommodations, even if their needs are minor. Two laws in particular, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA, and Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, are specifically designed to ensure that students with disabilities receive equal access to education and school activities. Both acts guarantee a free and appropriate public education, or FAPE, to all children regardless of ability. From simple accommodations intended to even the playing field, to special education services in typical classrooms with supplemental services, the laws are in place to provide valuable services to eligible children with disabilities. Basically, education services and classroom accommodations can be very helpful for students with mental or physical disabilities, especially for students with ADHD. Now, there are two main types of education services you can put in place. An individualized education program, or IEP, is a written document that outlines goals for your child, as well as the educational, developmental, and behavioral support and services your child will receive in order to help them reach these goals. An IEP is for students with ADHD that qualify under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA. Now, if your child does not qualify for an IEP, you can potentially get another one, which is called a 504 plan, in place, because the definition of a disability is much broader under Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973 than it is under IDEA. So, if your child does not qualify for services under IDEA, he still may be able to qualify for services under Section 504. Section 504 states that a student with a disability is defined as having a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits one or more major life activities. Since learning is considered a major life activity, many students with ADHD qualify as a person with a disability under Section 504. A 504 plan is basically a less specific plan of accommodations that's usually offered as some sort of a consolation prize for students who are not deemed sufficiently disabled to qualify for an IEP. There are tons and tons of examples of classroom accommodations, too many to cover in this video, but we cover much more of them in our upcoming course. So be sure to sign up for our waitlist if you want more information. The link is in the description. In the meantime, here are some examples that have proven to be effective. Seating the student close to the teaching area and away from distractions of doors and windows. Reducing the length of the student's workload, both classroom assignments as well as homework, to accommodate his or her attention span. Giving assignments one at a time rather than all at once, and breaking longer assignments into smaller parts so it isn't so overwhelming for the student. Allowing the student extra time to take tests and complete assignments. This is especially helpful for those children with a predominantly inattentive type ADHD who tend to process information at a slower speed and often take longer with tasks. Allowing the student to take tests or work on assignments in a quiet area free from distractions. Providing the student copies of class notes or assigning a study buddy to help in note-taking. Allowing the student to tape record teachers' directions regarding assignments as well as class lectures to help in recall and learning. Giving the student frequent physical breaks for movement and exercise during the day in order to help recharge, maintain focus, and burn off any excess energy or feelings of restlessness. setting up a system of communication, such as a notebook or daily emails or phone calls between parent and teacher so that they may keep each other informed about the student's progress or difficulties. These can also be teacher-implemented reward programs that often utilize point systems and communication with parents via daily report cards. We talk about using daily report cards in our video about ADHD behavioral therapies that I mentioned earlier. For more information on special education services and procedures, contact your local school district or your state Department of Education. You will also find information and support at your state Parent Training and Information Center and at the Office of Civil Rights. Now, how and when should you use these education services? Well, special education services and support should be provided in the least restrictive environment. Often children with ADHD continue in the regular classroom with appropriate modifications and accommodations rather than being placed in a separate special needs classroom. Being removed from the regular mainstream classroom would only happen if the student continues to struggle significantly in the regular classroom, despite accommodations and interventions. Now, why do education services help? Why do kids with ADHD need them? Specific behavioral classroom management interventions have been shown to be effective for managing youth's symptoms and improving their functioning at school and with peers. Dr. Russell Barkley, a clinical professor of psychiatry at the Virginia Treatment Center for Children and Virginia Commonwealth University Medical Center, states that students with ADHD know what to do, but they don't know how to do what they know, which means that all the interventions need to be made in their direct environments where they are not doing what they know they should be doing, like at home and at school. Kids with ADHD have the right information, but have a hard time acting on that information in a given moment. For example, if you ask, Billy, do you know that it's wrong to get up and walk around the class while I'm teaching? Or do you know that it's wrong to hit others? Billy will say, yes, I know that's wrong. But in the moment, Billy sees his pencil needs to be sharpened and impulsively makes the decision to get up and go sharpen his pencil, or he'll be angry at a classmate who insulted him and will hit him without stopping to consider whether that's wrong or not. So by creating constant physical reminders or accommodations in a student with ADHD's environment, it allows them to take the time to make the right decisions that they know are right. Now let's go over how can you get education services in place for your child. First, you have to understand who is eligible and why. Many schools offer special education services to children with ADHD who qualify. Educational specialists help the child, parents, and teachers make changes to the classroom and homework assignments to help the child succeed. IDEA, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, regulations issued by the U.S. Department of Education in March 1999 make it clear that attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD or ADD as it was previously known, is included in the list of conditions that could render a child eligible for special education services. However, including ADHD does not automatically mean that all children with ADHD qualify for an individual education plan or other provisions under IDEA. According to the Office of Special Education Programs, or OSEP, all children with ADHD clearly are not eligible under Part B to receive special education and related services, just as all children who have one or more of the other conditions listed under the other health impairment category are not necessarily eligible. For example, children with a heart condition, asthma, diabetes, and rheumatic fever. While IDEA does offer help for eligible children with ADHD, not all children who have ADHD are eligible. Even a medical diagnosis of ADHD does not necessarily guarantee eligibility of services. To qualify, the ADHD must adversely affect a child's educational performance. ADHD has various levels of severity. For some students, it is completely debilitating, requiring extensive accommodations and other interventions. Other students are more successful at managing their ADHD and have little trouble in the regular classroom. Decisions about the need for special services and/or accommodations are supposed to be made on an individual basis, with considerations given to the specific needs of the individual student. That's why the law is called the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. Emphasis is placed on the individual student. Now, when would an ADHD student qualify for special services under IDEA? A 1991 memorandum from the U.S. Department of Education to chief state school officers describes when a student might qualify for special education services under IDEA. According to the memo, children with ADHD may be eligible for services under the following categories, depending on their unique characteristics and identified educational needs. Other health impairment. Most children receiving special education services for ADHD alone will likely be classified as other health impaired. Since the regulations implementing IDEA now list ADHD as a condition that can make a child eligible under this category, Children with ADHD may meet eligibility criteria for the other health impairment category when their heightened alertness to environmental stimuli results in limited alertness with respect to the educational environment, impairing school performance. Next is specific learning disability. IDEA defines learning disability as a disorder in one or more of the basic psychological processes involved in understanding and using language that impairs the ability to listen, think, speak, read, write, spell, or do mathematical calculations. Children with ADHD may be eligible for special education in this category if they have coexisting learning disabilities. However, in some cases, ADHD alone could generate the type of impairment that would cause a child to meet criteria under this category, especially for the inattentive type, which has been linked to deficits in mathematics and sensory information processing. Minimal brain dysfunction, a condition listed under the specific learning disability category, was in fact the term for ADHD during most of the 1960s. Recent brain imaging studies and current understanding about ADHD's effect on executive functions, and hence on information processing, also underscore this category's continued relevance. The next is emotional disturbance. Children with ADHD sometimes have coexisting emotional and mental disorders, such as a mood disorder, behavior disorders, or anxiety disorders, that can adversely affect educational performance and make them eligible for special education services. Characteristics of emotional disturbance under Part B include 1. An unexplained inability to learn or to form and maintain satisfactory relationships with teachers and peers. 2. Inappropriate behavior and feelings. 3. General mood disorder symptoms. And 4. Physical symptoms or fears resulting from personal or school problems. The next is developmental delay. IDEA offers a non-categorical option, which is called developmental delay. For children aged 3 through 9 who exhibit delays in physical, cognitive, communication, emotional, social, or adaptive development, at the discretion of the state and local educational agencies, schools can use this option to serve children within the specified age range who need special education and related services because of such delays. Children with ADHD often seem immature for their age, lagging behind peers up to 30%, and have been found to score below average on tests used to identify developmental delays. These results are consistent with neurological findings that are leading researchers to view ADHD as a neurodevelopmental disorder. Some functional areas in which delays are evident include socialization, communication, daily living, and self-control. Social failure is so prevalent with ADHD that it is considered to be a characteristic of the disorder. So the children who qualify for services under IDEA will be given an individual education program, or IEP. The IEP is written by a team of people, including parents, the special education teacher, any regular classroom teachers who work with the child, and other professionals. It should describe the child's specific learning problems and how these problems are going to be dealt with, including goals and ways to measure progress. Children with disabilities, including ADHD, who are determined not to be eligible for special education services under IDEA may still be protected and served under two other federal laws. Section 504, which we covered earlier, of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, Section 504, and the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990, or ADA. The Office for Civil Rights in the U.S. Department of Education enforces the provisions of Section 504 and Title II of the ADA with respect to school districts, while the Department of Education administers IDEA. Public schools are required to offer these services for qualified children, which may be free for families living within the school district. The school system is responsible for identifying and evaluating children who are suspected of having disabilities. As a parent, you may request an evaluation for your child at any time. It is often helpful to put the request in writing in addition to talking to your child's teacher and school principal. If the outcome of the school evaluation indicates that your child meets the criteria for special education services, you and school personnel will meet to develop an individualized education plan specifically tailored to your child. Now, what about for a 504 plan? The school system will determine if your child qualifies for specialized services and accommodations under Section 504. You may take a request for services by submitting the request in writing to your child's school. Be sure to ask for a copy of your school's district policies and procedures on Section 504 so you can better understand your rights and responsibilities as well as those of the school. There is a ton of information about getting education services and accommodations for your child. Way too much to cover in this one video. Additude Magazine and CHAD, both authoritative sources on ADHD, have shared many resources that are highly relevant to school. I've linked to a curated list of them in the description below and highly recommend reading them before undergoing the process of securing accommodations for your child. For even more specific information, step-by-step guides, and access to professionals who can help you through this process, please sign up for our course. The link is also in the description. In the meantime, you can research all you can about ADHD and opportunities that are available to help your child be successful. You are your child's best advocate. Ask about school programs. Talk to your child's teachers. Stay in close communication with teachers and support their efforts to help your child in the classroom. Be sure teachers closely monitor your child's work, provide positive feedback, and are flexible and patient. Ask they be very clear about their instructions and expectations. So now you know what to expect from specialists in regards to ADHD treatment with education services. But remember that there are many other ways of treating ADHD. We've prepared some special offers for you at the end of this video. But first, to make sure that you're as prepared as you can be, I want you to hit the notification bell below and join our newsletter because we'll be hosting an online conference about ADHD during the middle school years. And we have brilliant speakers covering all the different aspects of helping your child with ADHD through middle school challenges, both at school and at home. To give you an idea, these experts and a bunch of others have already committed to speaking at our online event. Dr. Sarah Levin Allen, PhD and CBIS, who is a pediatric neuropsychologist and the executive director of Brain Behavior Bridge, Dr. Sarah Wheeler, also PhD, who is a school psychologist, licensed educational psychologist, and credentialed special education teacher, Daniel Kramarski, who is both a teacher and administrator, formerly the middle school dean at the Dalton School, director of student life at the Lycée Français de New York, instructor at Columbia University Teachers College, and an ADHD parent to his daughter with ADHD, who is now currently a student at American University. And Dr. Conchetta M. Dicaria, PhD, who is a psychologist, clinical neuropsychologist, and an experienced provider of diagnostic consultation and evaluation services to hundreds of middle school age children and their families. We'll be sharing information about the online conference on this YouTube channel and exclusive deals on our newsletter. So again, hit the notification bell and the subscribe button under this video and sign up to our newsletter using the link in the description to get early access and exclusive deals. If you like this video, please don't forget to like it and let us know what you liked or what you'd like to see more of in the comments below. The more people like, subscribe, click the bell, and comment, the more people will see this kind of content on YouTube, and we know some people could really use the help. Now, our expert-vetted newsletter will be free until January 2020, so don't wait up. Our resources will help you find answers to your basic questions about ADHD, understand why middle school is so challenging for students with ADHD, and introduce you to ADHD support groups and other sites to help you meet your child's needs both at school and at home. Visit the links in the description and on your screen. Now, if your child is being treated for ADHD, support groups can help parents and families connect with others who have similar problems and concerns. Groups often discuss regularly to share frustrations and successes, exchange information about recommended specialists and strategies, and talk with ADHD experts. So you can join our own expert-moderated ADHD education and support group for parents where you can get direct help from other parents and experts with shared experiences. I've put the link in the description and on your screen. Now, while you're waiting for our next video, make sure to check out these two videos right here. We share tons of expert-vetted resources on parenting and education for differently abled kids, just like kids with ADHD. So make sure to check out these two videos as well. As always, I appreciate you taking the time. Thank you for watching, and see you soon.